Welcome to another sermon from All People Christian Church. It is our hope that this message will encourage, inspire, and challenge you in your walk with God.
Let me jump into actually part three of this five-part series we're doing. I usually don't do ones that long. This is a longer one, and I'm excited about it. And the reason is because, I think it's on the next slide, if you go to our website, you will see a page that looks like this. Now, it's one of the sub pages. You have to go into the About Us, which is common on just about any church's website. They have an About Us kind of portion. And in that About Us, we have a page that shows our core tenets of faith, the things that basically make us Christians. It's what separates us from not only other world religions, but even other alternative versions of Christianity. And this is something, that particular page would hopefully be the same on any Bible-believing church in the world. I have my friends who today I was meeting for the first time. They're Filipino by birth. And I was telling them how I've spent so much time in the Philippines. Some of my best friends are from there. I feel like I practically lived in Manila. That's where our international offices are located even. And if you went to our churches in the Philippines, you'd have see the same exact tenets of faith on their website. But that's not everything a Christian believes. It's just the core of the faith that we're not negotiating. We're not voting on it. We're not discussing it or reevaluating it. It has held the church in place for 2,000 years, and it will continue to do so until Jesus comes back. Amen? It's what gives you security. Have you noticed that in culture, what is considered good and what's considered bad tends to change? Have you noticed that at all? Because if you've been around like I have. In my lifetime, there are things that once were called evil that are now called good, things that were called good that are now called evil. And that will continue to happen in culture for as long as there is a culture. But what keeps us anchored is the unchangeable, immutable, eternal truths of God in his word. Amen. That's what gives us some security in the midst of so much shifting and change in our world, especially if you haven't noticed during this whole COVID pandemic that seems like it's going on forever and ever. I believe one day we won't be talking about it. There will come a day, but I gave up predicting when that day is, by the way. And if talk about change, I mean, we canceled the Olympics, for goodness sake. I mean, who in your lifetime would have thought you could cancel the Olympics? They plan those things out like 40 years in advance. Or, I mean, you name it, stuff has been canceled. So in the midst of all that change, these things give us the foundation. But the theological distinctives, we made another page, and this is not something every church does, but we felt inspired to do it. And it was to let them know that the following are theological perspectives that help to distinguish who we are as a community of believers. They are important and valuable doctrines. Say important and valuable. Yes, but they are not considered the core tenets of our Christian faith. Rather, they are the result of our background, our values, our experiences, and the best interpretation of Scripture. You see, there is no human being but God himself, Jesus Christ, who has perfect doctrine. Okay, I'm just going to let you know that. I can prove that because there are some of the most committed Christians in the world who disagree on something called eschatology, how the world's going to end. Which one's right? I don't know. They might be both wrong. You know what I mean? So, but fortunately, they're still in the same family, right? And it says, as such, we embrace these. They are very important to us, believe them, and we pursue them, but we humbly recognize that other sincere Christians may not agree with some or all of them. And I pray at a pastor's prayer meeting in the city here, for example, with people who don't agree with me on everything. Not everybody in our churches vote for the same person or have the same exact conviction about, you know, masking or vaccines or about, you know, other political issues that may be going on in the world or about, you know, their favorite football team or baseball team or whatever. But if you're in the same family, you're in the same family. Amen. And that's what makes us family. And the core tenets of faith are what make us family. And everybody believes these other things too. They just might have a slightly different perspective. So I'm going to teach you today the third one. The reason this is a five-part series is because on that distinctives page, we have 10 different distinctives. There's no magical thing to that number, although there's 10 commandments. That's kind of cool. But five of them I'm doing in this series. The other five I'm going to spread out over the fall between now and Christmas into some other series. But this one is cool because two things. One, you might be wondering, why would you even have to teach on the issue of praise and worship? I mean, isn't that such a fundamental, foundational part of the Christian faith that everybody should be on the same page about that? You haven't seen how many denominations there are in the world. And many of them have divided over even this issue. You know, we don't believe instruments. No, no instruments. Or no, it should only be an organ. No guitar. You know, it should be only at this volume. It should be when you dress a certain way. I mean, there are 8,000 different opinions in the body of Christ on how you should do, especially the musical portion of praise and worship. And I'm just like, amen. Yes, to all of them. I've been to every kind of worship service you can dream of. I even did a wedding recently. It's not a wedding, excuse me. God bless him. A dear brother of ours that was a student years ago, one of the first student leaders we had in our ministry, he died in a tragic accident in Lake Tahoe. He drowned up there. You might remember him. He was a football player, and they still have a memorial for him up there. And I had to fly out to Hawaii to do his funeral at his Episcopalian campus. And the Episcopalian minister was the one leading it. I was just kind of her assistant. And I had to wear the thickest, biggest robes you have ever seen with these big old like scarves and stuff. And it was like 89 degrees in like 105% humidity, it felt like, outside for this funeral. I have never sweat that much in my life. But I wasn't like, oh, I don't wear robes. I'm a contemporary Christian. You know, I was just like, robes, no robes. I'm preaching the gospel. Amen. So get over ourselves and let's just focus on what does matter. So this one simply says that the Bible encourages a freedom of praise and worship, allowing people to worship in an authentic and uninhibited fashion, all the while following the 1 Corinthians 14 principle, I call it that, of doing so in a manner that is orderly and respectful of others and that does not draw attention to themselves or away from the Lord. Because worship is supposed to be focusing on God, not on how great you sing or what an awesome guitarist you are. You know, I remember one of the most unique experiences I've ever had in my many was I attended a very large mega church for a season of time, and I wanted to go there just to see what it was they were doing to reach so many non-Christian people in the city because I was impressed and inspired. So I wasn't going there to criticize and judge, although there's definitely things they did there that I would do differently. But I thought, hey, I'd love to have all these people in my church, you know, in this gigantic, beautiful building they have. That'd be pretty awesome too. But the one thing I struggled the most with in the 6 months or so we went there was the sermons. They were pretty simple, but they were still good. And I enjoyed the speaking. People were nice as all get up and everything. But the musical worship, man, I was dying. After about 6 months, I was like, man, I don't know. I got to go worship in my car or something after. And I'm not being critical. I'm just saying that it was more like a rock concert than it was a time of worship. I later found out that many of the, quote, worship leaders weren't even saved. They weren't even Christians. They weren't born again. They were professionals who played in the local shows in the city and who were hired by this large church with a large budget so that they could have the best possible singers and musicians that they could put on the stage. Now, that's one where I think I will depart from that and say, I'm not sure I'm okay. I'd rather just get up and I'll get up here with just this and just lead you guys, okay, in a song or something, than to put people who don't even know the Lord yet in front to try to lead us to the Lord. Doesn't quite make sense to me, you know? So then I figured out, no wonder I was just kind of struggling, you know, the whole time. Because I've been in a situation, one of the most powerful worship moments I've ever had was when I was visiting a church in Palm Desert, California. And I was literally, no exaggeration, I think I was the only person there, I was single at the time, that was under the age of 70. I mean, it was the ultimate, you know, white-haired crowd, as we would say. And it was a beautiful group of people, lovely, wonderful people, just one lady on the organ up front, not even that great at the organ. And we were singing out of the hymnals like I did when I grew up. And you would think like, oh, dude, boring, you know, like, oh, you must have been really struggling. No, I was so in love with Jesus that I started looking at the words we were singing. I'm like, these are powerful. Like, wow, John Wesley wrote some of these. And what I was like, this is good stuff. Luther wrote that one, you know, like, this is really good. And I just remember worshiping and singing with all my heart. It was some of the closest moments I've ever had with God. And yet, you know, on paper, it wouldn't have been half of what we could even produce here on a Sunday morning. So it's not about whether you raise your hands, dance, or have a great guitarist. It's your heart. Amen. So that's why I want to say this. In finishing the introduction, this is all I want to say about it. Worship is the most natural thing we can do. I want to tell you that. So first thing I want you to get about this is worship is the most natural thing. This is not something, even though when you are new to church, right? If you're new to church or new to the faith, you come to church, and usually most churches will start, and I'll explain why, with a musical portion of the worship service, right? I say musical portion because we consider all of what we're doing, including the preaching, as worship. Everything we should be doing should be an act of worship. If you're sweeping around the house, out on your back porch, you should be doing it to the glory of God. There was a great monk who wrote a book. His name was Brother Andrew, and his book is an all-time bestseller, and he wrote it centuries ago, and I remember reading it. He would talk about how he would do all the chores around the monastery, and every time he'd be down on his knees scrubbing or mopping or doing whatever, he would just fall down and start worshiping God because everything he did was an act of worship. Man, that book inspired me. You know, a monk, you know, from centuries ago who I don't have much in common with. The guy's never even seen the Super Bowl. Nothing, you know what I mean? And yet, I was so inspired by his faith. So it's the most natural thing we can do. Let me prove it to you. Look at Psalm 100. I love this psalm. And here's what the psalmist wrote. It said, shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Say, all the earth. Did you know all of creation is meant to worship God? The Bible even says that. And says that it groans and longs for the return of God and the restoration of all things that were corrupted when sin entered this world. I believe birds, when they're flying and chirping and singing, and the mountains up at Lake Tahoe. You ever been up there? I mean, come on. And you look around, you go, there's a God. Come on. I remember talking to a young student one time, very dedicated geologist. And he was like, I was telling him how when I go on vacation in Lake Tahoe, I just sit and look out the window at all of God's creation, and I just feel the awesome presence of God. And he was like, I look at that, I just see millions of years of water and time. I'm like, wow, dude, that's sad. I'm sorry that that's what you think when you see it, because I like this version better. So all of creation is meant to worship God. This isn't something you do only if you're a good singer or whatever. You should worship God all the time in every way. It says, worship the Lord with sadness. Oops, did I read that wrong? Well, shouldn't you look depressed at church? Shouldn't Christians be the most negative, just, you know, depressed people in the world? Or should they be some of the most upbeat, positive people in the world? Not because they don't have problems, but because they know they have the solution, right? So worship him with gladness. Come before him singing with joy. Now, it didn't say only if you can do it on key all the time, because I'm not a great singer at all, but I sing with joy. Acknowledge that the Lord is God. Amen. He made us. That's why we worship him. And we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. That's why it's natural to worship God. It's not natural to worship rock stars at a concert, but people do it all the time. I know. I went to many concerts before I was a Christian, and I've been to others since, and there was a big difference. Man, before we went, some of the nastiest people up on the stage, and everyone's like, awesome. Out of 2 Samuel chapter 6, David has taken over from Saul and become king now, right? David was on fire for God. Now, he had some issues, committed adultery, hired a guy to murder the dude, tried to cover it up. I mean, he had issues, but boy, this guy loved the Lord. And so check this out. He's married now to Saul's daughter, Michal. I can't say that right in Hebrew, Michal. Okay, so, and David danced. So check this out. They have finally recovered the stolen ark. And through a long story, they're now bringing it into Jerusalem, the city of David. And this is basically the ark at that point was the symbol of God, like God's presence was represented by that ark. So David, as the leader of the service, brings it in. And usually it would be women or someone like that who'd have tambourines, maybe doing a little dancing or something. Surely not a king. No way. That would be like you watching the president of the United States in his shorts, you know, doing something absolutely crazy. And you're like, that doesn't seem right. That just looks funny to me. You know what I mean? Now, here he is. He's bringing in this whole procession. It says, and he dances before the Lord with all his might, and to make it worse, wearing a priestly garment. Now, there's lots of arguments about was he naked? And then because it says it implied he disrobed and he was just wearing this thing called an ephod. It's like a two-sided apron, okay? So there's pictures of David, you know, kind of exposed wearing this. That would be interesting. Or they think maybe he just put that on. Either way, he wasn't the priest. He was the king. So it was also a bit inappropriate for him to be wearing this priestly garment. So it says, so David and all the people of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouts of joy and the blowing of ram's horns. Those babies are loud. So this wasn't just some quiet button-down service, right? But as the ark of the Lord entered the city of David, Michal, the daughter of Saul, his wife, is looking down from her window when she sees her husband, King David, leaping like this. My knee. And dancing before the Lord, she was filled, as you are right now, with contempt for him. Like, how dare he do that? I mean, she's looking at him like, that's my husband, the king? Looks like an idiot right now. So David returns home to bless his family. He's feeling good. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, comes out to meet him. And she says in disgust, she's like, how distinguished the king of Israel looked today, wink, wink, shamelessly exposing himself to the servant girls that were watching like any vulgar person might do. So here's what he said. David retorted, that's stronger, to Michal. He said, I was dancing before the Lord, woman, who chose me above your father and all his family. He appointed me as the leader of Israel, the people of the Lord, so I'm going to celebrate before the Lord. And yes, I'm willing to look even more foolish than that, than I did earlier, even to be humiliated in my own eyes. I'll preach the gospel to a friend, and he'll go, you're an idiot for believing in Santa Claus and God, and I don't care. He said, but those servant girls you mentioned, they're going to end up thinking I am distinguished because they saw uninhibited, authentic worship of God by a king of all people. So what happened to her? So Michal, the daughter of Saul, remained childless throughout her entire life. Be careful when you judge. Amen. Be careful when you judge. But notice how it says a freedom of praise and worship like we saw David do, allowing people like him to worship in an authentic and uninhibited fashion. There was nothing wrong with what David did, except that it offended his wife and maybe a few others who feel like, hey, I'm above that. I don't go to a church and raise my hands. That's just, not cool. Well, you know what you do if somebody pulls you over and tells you to get out of the car and show your hands? You better show those hands, okay? Because it's called surrender. And I do it all the time to God. Look at what it says also, though. Look at like one of the last Psalms, Psalms 150. It says, praise him with a little peep of the ram's horn. Does it say that, Jeremy, or what? Did I miss? What does it say? Blast of the ram's horn. That's loud. Praise him with the lyre and the harp. Some good stringed instruments, right? Praise him. We need a harp, AJ. We got to start doing that here. Praise him with the tambourine. We need that up here too. Mike, you're going to be in charge of tambourine up here, okay? You just got to dance a little bit, leaping before the Lord with your tambourine. Sound good? Okay. And dancing, that'll be my part. Praise him. I can't dance. Doesn't matter. My wife can, but I'll do it. Praise him with strings and flutes. We need some of those. Praise him with a clash of cymbals. Praise him with loud clanging cymbals. Man, these Jews, they would get crazy for God. I remember when I was a brand new young Christian in the early 90s, and the whole concept of contemporary worship music was, believe it or not, brand new. There was like two groups of people, remember this, Shelley, that even made music. There was Hosanna and Maranatha, right? And they all sang pretty much just simple tunes, but I loved them. And a bunch of them had like this Jewish vibe to them because they were straight out of Psalms. So at church, the worship leader would be like, all right, let's circle up here, you know, put your arm around each other. And we'd be like, Jehovah is mighty. And you're like, oh my gosh, you're an idiot. I didn't care. Worship God with all my heart, man. He said, I'll praise you as long as I live, lifting up my hands to you in prayer. And just in case you think that's an Old Testament thing, look in 1 Timothy from the New. Paul said, in every place of worship, I want men to pray with holy hands lifted up to God, free from anger and controversy. Do you know it's really hard to be a racist when you're raising your hand worshiping God? Do you know it's really hard to be severely judgmental of others when you're surrendered to God like this and raising your hand? Did you know it's really hard to keep and hold on to that bitterness that you love so much and resentment towards somebody when you're totally surrendered and just worshiping God? Amen. And then it goes on to say, praise his name with dancing, accompanied by tambourine and harp. You know, that one right there is my favorite. I told Eunice before church this funny story, true story. There was a woman when I first became a Christian. You got to remember, I had been going for several years to some of the wildest, craziest fraternity parties you had ever seen. Dressed in costumes, people drunk, doing all kinds of crazy stuff, standing on tables, taking their shirt off, dancing around in the bar, you name it, right? And then I get saved and I go to this church that's full, it's this multi-ethnic church. It's like almost a quarter black, white, Latino, Asian. It's just amazing. A lot of younger people. The band, we had several people from the USC Trojan marching band, one of the greatest bands in the world, that were on the worship team. So they loved God and they were great. And I mean, we went there and I remember the first time I went, I was like, holy moly, this is like a fraternity party. These people are going for it. And we'd sing like six songs. You imagine trying to pull that off because service was 2 hours, Lord forbid. We'd sing like six songs and we were just going for it. I mean, it was just fun. And I wasn't drunk. I remembered all of it. It was wonderful. And I just was into it. So I finally became a bit infamous for, I would go and find my little corner up near the front and kind of away. And I would just be like, dancing and just loving Jesus with all my heart, this crazy fraternity guy. And I'd be like doing some moves, some white guy moves, you know, because I have that disease really bad. And there is no cure for it. My wife, the Eastern European Jew, is the funkiest woman you've ever seen, can do any dance known to man. And then there's me. Okay. So I'm over there and I don't care. I'm just like David. Now I'm dressed, so, you know, I wasn't just wearing the ephod, but I'm over there. And I remember this one lady came up. She's this tall, beautiful African-American woman. She looked just like Eunice. She had these beautiful braids. And she comes over, and I didn't even hardly know her. And she goes, her name was Summer. And she goes, "Brother, you was operating. You was operating up there." And I was like, "Amen, Summer. Thank you." She goes, "I like watching you worship. You go for it." And I was like, "I feel a bit foolish." She's like, no, you just keep going. Do your thing, brother." And I was like, "Amen." Never stopped. Now I'm a pastor. I got too many things to think about. You know, so only once in a while am I going to embarrass you like that. Plus, there's not enough room in here yet. And so we'll create some more dance floor room. So what do we do about the second part of this? Let me move on. We'll do the second, third, and then call it even. And we'll end with some worship here, guys. All the while, though, following the 1 Corinthians 14 principle of doing so in a manner that is orderly and respectful of others. So there is a limit. There is a balance here. For example, I had a friend in Las Vegas who had some new transfer members come to his church from another church because they were disgruntled and angry there. So then they came there, and that's always a bit of a concern at first when that happens. And their thing was they brought their flags. No, they're dancing streamers. And they would just be running all around during service with their dancing streamers. But it was a bit distracting, and it didn't fit the flow of the service. So the pastor gently tried to say something to them, and they were like, "Well, that's what the Lord wants me to do, so I'm going to do it." And it was like, "Well, it's not always just your decision, person. Okay, you know, maybe there's other people involved, and maybe you're not following this whole thing." I mean, Paul writes an entire chapter to this church in Corinth about the gifts of the Spirit and how they're to be practiced in a public gathering, because this church was made up primarily of a bunch of converted Greeks who had gone to these crazy temples where you would just shout out in various kinds of tongues or do whatever in no particular order. There was total chaos, and the more that you were kind of crazy, the more spiritual you seemed. So they brought that into the Christian church with them, and he's like, "Look, I pray in tongues more than all of you. I love it, and prophecy, eagerly desire it. It's good, but there's a way to do this, okay?" So he starts breaking it down for him. Here's what he says in that chapter. I'm not going to read the whole thing, just a little bit. He goes, "Well, my brothers and sisters, let's summarize." Okay, so if the Apostle Paul says, "Let's summarize," that should mean you scoot up on your chair like, okay, so bottom line, when you meet together, you should have somebody who sings. Like Eunice doesn't try to sing over AJ or vice versa. They've decided in advance who's going to lead what. Another's going to teach. So I'm teaching right now. That's why you do small group, because you can't really raise your hand in the middle of the sermon and then interrupt with questions. So you go to small groups so you can break it down, discuss it together, right? And he goes, another will give some special revelation. That's like prophecy God has given. One will speak in tongues, and another will interpret what is said. So in a public gathering from the front, if you're going to speak in tongues, you need to do it with a purpose, not just do it to show off or whatever. But everything, say everything, that is done must strengthen you personally, you yourself, and you. No, strengthen all of you. So if you want to dance with streamers or whatever, I'm not saying that's wrong. I've been places where that's happened, but it's got to be in the context of what's going on and not just bless you, but bless everybody. So he even gets down to, this is how practical he gets in the scriptures. He's like, so look, no more than two or three should speak in tongues. If they speak one at a time, they should do it one at a time. Someone should interpret what they say. But if no one is present who can interpret, then they must be silent in your church meeting and just go and speak in tongues to God privately. So I've done that before, where I'll be in worship, we'll be singing. I may just be singing in the Spirit or praying in the Spirit because I feel inspired to, but I'm not interrupting anybody. I'm not making a scene. It's just, you know, drowned out by the flow of what's going on. But if I'm going to come up in front of church at the pulpit in the middle of service and say something in tongues, then I'm expecting somebody, that myself or another person, to interpret that. Otherwise, you're just like, all right, that, hope you enjoyed that. I have no idea what you said, but that was great. You know, I mean, it's like, you know, you got to do it for other people, right? He said, so, he goes on, say, so, my dear brothers and sisters, here's where he, as a good leader, was careful. He's like, I'm trying to bring some order, but I don't want to put your fire out. So I'd rather someone knock over a speaker sometimes or whatever, because Matt's worshiping so intensely, and I have to maybe help him, like, you know, you should worship over here 5 feet from the speaker, social distance from that, whatever. But I'd rather have that than him just dead as a doornail, you know, and I have to maybe put a little form to it, right, band? You'd rather people be singing too loud, and you're like, okay, I can't hear myself. You guys calm down a little bit, right? He says, so my dear brothers and sisters, be eager to prophesy, and whatever you do, don't forbid speaking in tongues. So don't go to the other extreme now, like so many other Christians have said, and said, oh, I had one bad experience, so we don't do that ever. Or I had a bad experience at church, so I don't go to church anymore. Wow, that does not make sense. I met a hypocrite Christian once, so I'm not going to serve the Lord. Okay, so you're going to sacrifice your eternal destiny because of that idiot. You know, that's not worth it. So he said, just be sure that everything is done properly and in order. Amen? Amen. So we're going to practice some of this as we go along here and finish. And last but not least, it says that does not draw attention to themselves or away from the Lord. What do I mean by that? Well, there's a couple stories that come to my mind of the many experiences I've had over the years. I remember one being when I worked as the national director for our campus ministry arm of the ministry that we're part of. We did a big fundraising banquet in Los Angeles. And this was a very formal event. People were all dressed up, coat and tie, nice outfits, whatever, catered banquet at this nice Marriott hotel downtown LA. And everything. And we had invited people that were supporters of the ministry there. And we had a speaker, we had an itinerary, we had agenda, a very formal event, right? Not the kind of place that you would just break out into spontaneous craziness, right? But as our guest speaker was up in the middle of speaking, this one woman who had just grown up in a church culture this way, she just decides to start yelling out a quote-unquote prophecy. And then she just interrupts and just takes over. It starts. Then she gets up, and then she starts walking all across the front. Like, I wasn't sure if she was convulsing. I was nervous. I mean, talk about uncomfortable. It was uncomfortable. And this went on for like 5 minutes. And she's like, and the Lord's saying this. And I mean, I don't even remember what she said. It didn't seem like it really fit with what was going on. And it had been fine if she came up after and said, man, as you were speaking, I felt like the Lord said this, you know, et cetera, wrote a note even, whatever. There's an appropriate way to do it, right? This was not. So the poor speaker had to get off the stage, stop, and kind of escort her around to make sure she was okay, because we thought she was going to fall over. She was older, a little bit bigger, et cetera. And we were just like, wow. That's drawing attention to yourself. I don't think that's the Lord. I remember one other story, and I'll show you the scripture. Of when I was co-pastoring a church for a couple years in Las Vegas, we had taken our original church, merged it with another, and I was co-pastoring with this guy. And we had this one woman who had come in, similar. She was older, had come from this kind of background. And when we worshiped, Jerry, she would literally scream. But it was like a blood-curdling, like, out of a horror film kind of scream. It was so disturbing. And nobody could worship because as soon as you heard it, it was like, ah, you know, and then they'd all look over like, oh my gosh, is she okay? Is, you know, somebody needs to help her. And she would just keep doing it. So of course I get the job of talking to her, right? Yeah, thanks. That's when you don't want to be a pastor. So I have to go over because my co-pastor was leading worship. So I'm the one stuck doing it. So I have to go over and I have to go, I'm Sister Betty, God bless you. Thank you. I love your enthusiasm. It is so encouraging. I said, but the only thing is some of the screaming that you're doing is making people worry and they're not able to concentrate on the Lord. And you would have thought I ran over her dog twice. I mean, she just went off. She's like, this, the Lord is telling me to do this, and this is what the Lord is leading me to do. This is how I worship the Lord. This is what, and I was like trying to explain, like, I appreciate that, but that's not how we are worshiping the Lord. Like, there's some order that needs to happen here. And she, of course, big shock, she left the church not long after, etc. What does the Bible say, though? Remember that people who prophesy, which is a spiritual gift generated by the Holy Spirit using your spirit within you, like praying in tongues, prophesying, are in control, say in control, of their spirit and can take turns. The only spirit that will ever take you over your body and make you do things you don't want to do and look crazy and stupid or dangerous is a demonic spirit. The Holy Spirit, say Holy Spirit, will never do that. The Holy Spirit, we like to give him time at every service, even though I pray and the leaders, we pray all week about the itinerary, what is God saying, what should we do this week, etc. It's usually pretty similar order. And then there's a moment during even the music that we'll just say, hey, this is not scripted. What does the Holy Spirit want to say right now in case somebody has a prophecy, a word, a scripture, something, right? Because there could be something we didn't catch. But it's done in order. It's done with guarded boundaries to, and the Holy Spirit is a gentleman. He always does things. He never takes over a meeting and does crazy stuff unless he has to. Okay. And only you think it's crazy because you're not listening. He said, you can take turns. So you can pray when you want to. You know, I've prayed for somebody before, like, well, what if I get the gift of tongues and I'm praying, but then I'm like in the checkout counter, you know, at the store, and I burst out into tongues uncontrolled. I'm like, that doesn't happen. Doesn't work like that. You have control over who you are and what you do. For God is not a God of disorder, but of peace, as in all the meetings of God's holy people. Amen. Now, what we do as people is we overorder it. We squeeze God out. We so plan it down to the minute detail that we're like, God, I'm sorry, Holy Spirit, no, you go in the back. No, that's not on the agenda, Holy Spirit. I know you're God. I know you're all wise and you created the universe, but we've got an agenda here. It shouldn't work like that either, right? And then finally, check this out. This is a famous one, right? You've heard this. We've used it to try to keep women in their place even, right? And that's not one of our distinctives. And I want women to be modest in their appearance. Paul the Apostle wrote, they should wear decent and appropriate clothing. Now, he's talking about something that's not sensual there. But then, and I believe in that, we have a dress code for our band. We ask women in the band not to wear anything too revealing that then distracts people, young single guys from not being, or anybody from not being able to worship the Lord. But at the same time, same goes for the guys. But not draw attention. Look at that. Say, draw attention to themselves by the way they fix their hair, braiding it, they talked about, or by wearing gold or pearls or expensive clothes. Because back in that culture, if you got your hair braided, that was like considered a massive luxury. Took a lot of time and money to do that. For women who claim to be devoted to God should make themselves attractive by the good things they do. Now, so many have used this because he goes on to talk about what's right for teaching and whatever and so on, to kind of just say, like, women just play only a secondary submissive role, men should do all the leading or whatever. And I don't think that's, we have another distinctive that I'll be doing on this issue and that talks about that. But it's not also just to the other extreme either, where it's just a free-for-all. But what he's saying here is that male or female, say male or female, you're not to show up to church in a way that you are trying to draw all the attention to yourself. If AJ decided to get a rainbow colored mohawk, you know, I'd be like, dude, let's talk about this first, because you're leading worship and no one can think of anything but your rainbow colored mohawk. Okay, so let's rethink that. Is that appropriate, or are you drawing? Or if you come in and you're dripped, I mean, with ice, right? Ice. That's diamonds, guys. Come on, be cool. If you're dripping in ice and gold and everything else, right? And it's just out there, man, just drawing all this, like somebody's just like, just drop one of those in the offering bucket. We'll be good for a year, you know, and you're just covered. That's probably not doing it either, right? Or if you're dressing in a way that's just way too revealing or whatever, that's probably not good either, because it's just inappropriate. So that's all he's talking about here. Amen. So he's not just picking on the women, by the way. Paul was not anti-woman. So let's go ahead. The band can make their way up here. And I'm just going to say this in summary. God created us to worship him with freedom and joy. We can even start moving the pulpit too if you want to, Connor. All the while doing so with order and respect. Amen? So that's what God does. He wants us to worship him with freedom. He doesn't want you worrying when you're worshiping. Part of why, you know why we turn the lights off during some of our songs? Because people have just flat asked us to. I don't actually like it, but I do it, and I'll tell you why. Because a lot of people have said, I feel too self-conscious when we're worshiping. I feel more comfortable if we just lower the lights. Fine. If that's going to help you, there's no doctrine against lowering the lights, okay? It's just that God does not want us to be so self-conscious when we're singing and worshiping that we're worried about what everybody else is doing and thinking, and we can't worship God. Amen? But at the same time, if you start knocking over people and chairs and the band and the speakers and setting off a fire, then we may have to put some restraints on that, Hezzy, okay? There's got to be a limit, bro. And not picking on you only this time, okay? But just settle down, bro. Okay, so then we got to do it in order. Amen? So I'm going to ask you to stand up again, even though you're used to being able to leave by now and refilling your coffee, and you're like, oh, I can't worship now. I'm too tired. I had to listen to this guy ramble. And then I've all the blood's in my legs now or wherever else. But no, get the blood flowing again. And we will lower the lights here to help for this first song. And then we'll turn them back on for the second. And this first song is just, I want you to focus on the words, what we're singing. There's a portion at the end. AJ's going to teach us. It's kind of new. We're going to just ask if the Holy Spirit has anything he wants to say. And then we're going to end with a really fun dancing, leaping with your, ephod on, the whole bit, celebration of Jesus and call it a day. Amen? Let's do it.
All right, so just like Pastor Bret was talking about, you know, we're going to sing a song, and if you want to sway or put your hands up or whatever way you want to worship, you know, now's the time to do it. Practice what he preached, right? There's no other name I know. In my weakness, powerful, it's you, only you. Oh, will never leave my side. In the quiet, in the fight, it's you, only you. Closer, take me in closer, deeper inside your perfect love. Jesus, my soul completion, always you are more than enough. There's no other name I know. In my weakness, powerful, it's you, only you. Who will never leave my side? In the quiet, in the fight, it's you, only you. Closer, take me in closer, deeper inside your perfect love. Jesus, my soul completion, always you are more than enough. Closer, take me in closer, deeper inside your perfect love. Jesus, my soul completion, always you are more than enough.
Closer to you, God. We want to see your power in our lives. But in order to do that, we need to be refined. We need to be burned of all of our iniquities so that all the world sees is a reflection off of your glory. This next part is called Refiner. A lot of times, we don't want to go through trials, but the process of being refined is all the gold and all the beautiful jewelry that we see, all the rust is burned off. So that the refiner grabs the piece of gold and see his reflection on it. That's our lives, ladies and gentlemen. Trials and tribulations come so that we reflect Jesus. Amen. I wanna be tried by fire, purified. You take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life. I wanna be tried by fire, purified. You take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life.
I want to be
tried by fire, purified. You take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life.
Clean.
Clean my hands. Purify my heart. I want to burn for you. Only for you, take my life as a sacrifice. I wanna burn for you, only for you.
Clean my hands,
clean my hands, purify my heart. I wanna burn for you. Only for you, take my life as a sacrifice. I want to burn for you, only for you. Clean my hands, purify my heart. I want to burn for you. Only for you,
take my life,
take my life as a sacrifice. I wanna burn for you, only for you.
I wanna be, if you'll let me, I'm sorry for interrupting. I think this week was unique for me for the purpose of sharing with you, church. I have been listening to a lot of these worship songs this week to kind of get myself in the mindset of what the Lord is trying to share through the words of the song. And I want to really draw ourselves, if the AV team can put the clean my hands, purify my heart slides up. I want you guys to think about those words, clean my hands. Because as we walk through this world, we start picking up, you know, if you guys can imagine the bacteria we pick up on this world, just like physical bacteria, but we're picking up sin as we're just going through the world. We're picking up sin without even trying to, because the world itself is desensitized to sin. And when we walk through this world that is so sinful, we become desensitized. But the Lord is trying to purify us, and that process is not always the easiest. Sometimes we're uncomfortable. Sometimes we feel like we cannot handle it. But the Lord is saying that we can, because through His Spirit, He is refining us. Through His Spirit, we can handle all things, right? So even if in our minds we're like, I can't do this, I can't handle this, I don't have the capability, He's saying, I can refine you, but I need you to be burning for me first. We need to be burning on fire for Christ, for Him to make an impact, for us to be refined, because the old you, it's going to be so hard to get rid of that, because it's interwoven with who you want to be. He's going to have to burn that apart, and you feel so close to that old you, but you need to be burning on fire for him. So that process is not going to be easy, but the first step is worshiping him in all we do, not just the musical part. It's great to worship him in the musical part now, but we need to be burning for him in everything we do. So for me, I'm a student. I'm a medical student. So when I'm studying, I shouldn't be thinking, oh, I want to be the smartest. No, I'm studying for you, Christ. Because you put me here, I'm studying for you. Those who are working. Every day I go to work, every day you wake up, think, oh God, I woke up this early for you. And that in itself is a blessing. That in itself is you burning for him. So as we sing this, church, I want us to really pay attention to that. Clean our hands, purify ourselves, burning for him, burning the old away.
Clean my hands, purify my heart. I wanna burn for you, only for you. Take my life as a sacrifice. I wanna burn for you, only for you. Clean my hands, clean my hands, purify my heart. I wanna burn for you, only for you. Take my life as a sacrifice. I wanna burn for you, only for you. I wanna be tried by fire, purified. You take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life. I wanna be tried by fire, purified. You take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life. I wanna be tried by fire, purified. You take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life. I wanna be tried by fire, purified. You take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life.
Thank you, God. Lord, we are so grateful today that we are not only allowed to speak to you as Abba Father through your Holy Spirit, who brought us into direct relationship with you and lives inside of us, but you also like to speak to us. Very rarely is that audibly, but it's always through your word, an impression on our heart, speaking to a person prophetically like you did Eunice today, or whatever it may be, God. So teach us how to not just talk, but how to listen as well. And Lord, I thank you also that we can sing slower tempo songs that cause us to reflect and to calm down and to worship you. And then we can cut loose, dance, and praise and party like David did in your presence as well. Hallelujah. I'm going to ask the ushers to flip the lights on. And I'm going to ask you to sing one last short song with me as we end on this note. This is meant to be fun. And if we want to make a train that goes down through the aisles and back through the back, maybe not. Whatever. That would be fun too. But take us here, guys. And if you really mean this, sing "Thank You, Lord." Act like you mean it.
Woo! We can have fun in church, amen? We are the lives of the party because Jesus lives in us. Okay, this first part, repeat after me. Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Our God says.
Our God says.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
And highest praises.
Highest praises.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, we give thanks.
We give thanks.
I'm grateful.
I'm grateful for who you are and all you've done. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Oh, my soul cries, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
And our God says.
Our God says.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Highest praises.
Highest praises.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, we give thanks.
We give thanks.
I'm grateful.
I'm grateful for who you are and all you've done.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Oh, my soul cries, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Oh, my soul cries, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Before we sing this part, let's just give praise to how great our God is. Amen. He's been so good to us when we don't deserve it. All right? Okay, follow me. We're going to sing, You've Been.
You've been so good. You've been so good. I thank you, Lord. I thank you. My heart is full, my heart is full. I love you, Lord, I love you. You've been so good, you've been so good. I thank you, Lord, I thank you. My heart is full, my heart is full. I love you, Lord, I love you. You've been so good, you've been so good. I thank you, Lord, I thank you. My heart is full, my heart is full. I love you, Lord, I love you.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Oh, my soul cries, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
One more time.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Oh, my soul cries, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
We hope you enjoyed this message from All People Christian Church. For more information about our church or for more sermons like these, please check us out on the web at allpeoplecc.com.